Hello YouTube, this is Chuck. Beautiful afternoon out here. I'm in a off of a little back road a few miles out of town. Place where I like to be. I like to be out in the country. And beautiful afternoon. It's Sunday, October 30th. About 3:30 in the afternoon, temperatures in the low 60s. Just a really nice day. So today I'd like to talk a little bit about my van and give you maybe a quick van tour. But before I do that, let me turn you around here and let me show you where we're at, because we got a million-dollar view from where we're at, and I'll tell you a little bit about it. So let me turn the camera around here, panning slowly. There are some other campers in the area. That set of cliffs you can see in the distance is the Mogollon Rim. And that's the south edge of the Colorado Plateau. The area that we're at is kind of referred to as rim country. The little mound you see kind of in the left center up there is the highest point on the rim. It's called Baker Butte. It's a little over 8,000 feet. There's a Forest Service fire tower up there. And as we pan across a little bit further, we're at about 5,250 feet right here. The top of what you're seeing up there is right around 7,800 feet. Just a beautiful, beautiful area. Got a little sun on the camera now. I can't really see what I'm filming. But that's where we're at. Like I say, million-dollar view. So anyway, let's come back and let's talk a little bit about the van. Now, I used to camp in a Jeep, and I'll show you a picture of that here in a little bit. I used to have it set up to where I could sleep in it, and I decided I wanted something that was be a little bit more comfortable and a little bit easier to get in and out of. And quite honestly, I got to the point where, being an older guy, I wanted to make sure I had a potty available. So I ended up buying this van 7 years ago. Didn't give much for it. I'll talk a little bit about more about the story, but let's kind of do a walk around so you can kind of see what it looks like. It's a 1991 Ford E250 Club Wagon. So the club wagon is the extended body version. It's a little bit longer than a regular one. As you can see, it's got the fiberglass add-on high top. 1991 was the last year of this particular body style. In 92, they went to the newer body style, which probably most of you are familiar with. And they used that body style right up until they quit making the Econoline van. And they still use a kind of a variation of that for the cutaways chassis that you can buy that are used for things like Class C motorhomes and ambulances and service trucks and that sort of thing. But I kind of like this old body style, and this particular one, it's got about 79,000 miles on it now, so it obviously spent a lot of time sitting in its life. So let me see if I can get around here without getting into the sun. It's kind of rocky out here where I'm at. I don't want to trip over a rock. That probably wouldn't be a good thing. We'll come back and show you what the inside of the doors look like. This paint job not in too bad a shape. There's a few places where the clear coat's kind of going away, but it's good, definitely good enough for what I do. So let's go around and look at the inside. First of all, this is what my old Jeep used to look like. I had it set up where I could sleep in it, and it all fit inside, and you couldn't even tell when it was hooked up. It had some advantages. It'd go anywhere a Jeep would go, but the disadvantages were, of course, it was open, so if it was cold, it's cold, and It was a little hard to get in and out of. I carried a little camp stove and stuff with me, so I was able to eat and all that kind of stuff like that. But it was a little awkward to get in and out of, and I used that for a number of years, and I finally decided I want something a little better. And so I ended up going ahead and getting the van. So let me set this back down. I'm not sure how well this is all going to show up and about the lighting conditions and this kind of thing. I've been pretty lucky so far in the videos I've been shooting. I've gotten pretty good light. But this one, I bought it. It was gutted. Actually, somebody had used it to haul dogs. And it smelled to high heaven like a dog kennel. And I had to deal with that. And that took me a little bit. It had some mechanical problems. But I only gave $1,400 for the van, so how can you? I can't expect too much. The top alone, there's only really one outfit that I'm aware of that even makes those tops anymore, and they're in Southern California, and called Fiberine. And a top like that would cost you right about $6,000. So paying $1,400 for the whole van seemed like a pretty good deal, and I think it was. Fortunately, I'm kind of handy and got a garage full of tools, and I was able to eventually fix a lot of things that's wrong with it. It's not perfect now. But as you can see, my back bed there, it was actually made on an old desk that I paid $25 for from the Habitat for Humanity store. And I had to, I took the legs off of it to lower it a little bit. It's a 60 by 30 desk. And in order to put the twin extra long mattress on it, which is an 8-inch memory foam mattress, I had to widen it 9 inches, which is over the wheel well, and I had to extend it 20 inches. That ended up working out pretty good because the 20-inch extension is where my porta potty's at. Let me see if I can get up in here. Well, before I do that, let me talk a little bit about my kitchen. My kitchen is this desk, and that was actually a $35 desk, and it's a 24-inch wide by 42-inch long desk. Drawer there behind the chair is actually where my silverware and stuff is. The top drawer on the left there is where my cups and dishes and that kind of thing live. The next drawer down is where my stove lives. And the bottom drawer is where my tea kettle and my stainless steel salad bowl live. And this salad bowl I use for a sink. The stove I can cook either inside or outside. You can see the shelves on the divider there. It's my coffee station and this kind of thing. The little red thing in the background in the center of the picture there is where I charge my phone, and I'll talk a little bit more about that kind of stuff. So with that, let me get up in here. The lighting actually shows up a little better doing that. So on the left side here, on the back, I have a Mr. Buddy heater that's fastened to the wall, and I have my Chase lounge and a couple of jackets. And a chair right up here. The green thing is a chair, and that's fastened to the wall as well. On the other side over here, it's kind of hard to do this. This camera isn't the greatest in the world for this. But that bottom drawer there is my pantry, and the next one above it has other food-related stuff in it. And the center drawer is kind of a junk drawer, and then the three drawers in the back, the top one has... Top one and the second one have clothing, and the bottom one has cleanup stuff. And then the porta potty's in the back there. And underneath that gray platform in the back, there is an extra battery, which is charged off the alternator. And then that's wired back up to my charging station. So I have both a starting battery and a coach battery. Getting up here, I'll come in. This is my t-shirts and stuff. I don't have much in here because I'm not out on a trip right now. I have a set of camp shoes and bug spray and sunscreen. Pivot back around. Maps that cover most of the national forest in Arizona where I go. And then look back here toward the front. And those upper shelves up there store a lot of my gear. That plastic bag on the second shelf there is a 0-degree sleeping bag. When I go someplace where it's really cold, I just tuck that inside the bed, and I can sleep down to about zero. The brown jacket up on top is Carhartt gear, Arctic gear. And I've got some other stuff up there that doesn't show up real well on the video. But this is gives me a lot of storage up there. I have, as you can see, I've got a curtain there I can pull across. I usually don't use that for privacy as much as I use it for when it's cold to keep the cold out. You lose a lot of heat through those front windows. Now that passenger seat swivels around. I didn't swivel it for this video. I probably should have. And so basically what happens is that front part ends up being my living room and kitchen. And the back part where I'm currently standing is my bedroom and bathroom. I keep it stocked up with food, so I've got enough food for about a week. And so I could get in it and leave and go. And one of my hobbies is I go and look for these guys. And I'll do videos about that. I haven't done one recently, but I'll do videos about that. And the short thing is yes, they're real, and yes, I've seen them. The whole truth is a lot more complicated than that. But figured I'd give you a quick little tour. I've got blackout curtains for these other windows if I need them. If I'm someplace where I'm actually need privacy, which I very seldom do where I go. I normally am in the back country. The back curtain, I can pull that to try to keep the heat in here a little bit. And headroom is about 6'6". I'm 6 foot tall, so I've got plenty of room to stand up and move around in here. And on the outside, you probably noticed I do have an awning. In fact, let's go back out there. I'm going to back up here and see if I can step outside here without falling over. There we go. It's a little kind of late afternoon. The angle of the sun isn't quite right. You notice that piece of trim there? This life is fantastic. That's actually, I'm trying to learn how to be a wood carver. And that's actually my first attempt at trying to freehand make signs with a router. And it actually didn't come out too bad. I kind of messed up on that top S up there on the word is. And that's because there was a little hard spot in the wood. But considering it was my first try, I didn't think it did too bad. So let me back up here a little bit. Obviously this door got fire extinguisher and my sign. This door here is actually a table. It folds up and sometimes I cook out there or just whatever I end up needing an outside table for. I carry an extra table as well. Let's move around here to the back. I put the not homeless on there because I had people ask me if I lived in this. And I probably could, but no, I have a wife and a house and all that stuff that goes with that. So there you can see my porta potty. I just pull it out and turn it 90 degrees to use it. I've got this thing, I don't like to look at a toilet when I'm sitting there. So it rides good back there where it's at. And I can just push it back. It's out of the way. It's out of sight, out of mind, but it's available if I need it. That's a real popular one among a lot of nomads. It's a Thetford Curve. And so it has a water tank and a flush pump. And so it actually flushes and has a cassette at the bottom. You can empty it anywhere. It's really, really handy. I've been using this van now exactly in the same configuration for about 6 years now. And it works just fine for what I use it for. You can see why I keep that curtain closed. If you look at that curtain, the bottom part is, you can see it's still black, and the top part looks gray. That's from the sun coming through these back windows. Those of you that know about Arizona, the sun in Arizona is pretty relentless. Looking at this little compartment over here in the corner, that goes back over the wheel well, so all my long stuff goes in there. And I have recovery gear. I have a long-handled shovel. I have my pole for my awning, poles for my awning. Carry a jump box there, obviously tow strap you can see, and so that's just a kind of a utility compartment. These old vans, the doors don't fit as good as they probably did when they were new, and they pull a lot of dust in there. So I run a lot of dirt roads, so a lot of this stuff back here gets pretty dusty. So let's go ahead and close that. Come on back around. That's kind of the short version. Those guys that are gearheads, motoring this is a 5.8 liter, which would be the 351 Windsor E4OD transmission. It's got 373 rear gears, which make it it's pretty happy at about 60. It's not really happy if you try to go much faster than that, and that's as fast as I want to go anyway. Mileage, I average about probably 12 mile a gallon, and of course this high top, you can well imagine that affects fuel mileage, and probably get a little bit better if I didn't have the high top, but I certainly wouldn't want to give it up for anything. It also makes it a bit of a challenge in crosswinds. I've driven on some trips with some pretty high crosswinds that kind of make it kind of a handful to drive. But I wouldn't want to give it up. There's the awning. The awning's manual, has a hand crank. I don't use it very much. Normally I'm not any place long enough. Sometimes if I'm going to be hunkered down for a couple days and it's going to be raining, I'll put the awning out just so I can have the doors open without getting rain inside there. So that's just a quick tour of the van. You'll be hearing more about that. I'll talk a little bit more about maybe some of the things about building it, and I'll show some other rigs of people that I've met, and I got kind of interested in the whole van life and schoolie life and the people that convert bread trucks and ambulances and different types of vehicles to live in. I've been to the RTR, the Rubber Tramp Rendezvous, and in January in Quartzsite, Arizona. I've been there a couple of times, and everybody on the road, everybody that lives a nomadic lifestyle, everybody's got their own story, and a lot of them are pretty interesting, and most of them are just pretty good down to earth people. Most of them aren't wealthy, but they're pretty good solid people, and there's a good community of people on the road. So that kind of wraps up my van tour. As always, wish you all have a good day, and love each other, be nice to each other. And let me put back around here. Thanks for watching my videos, and thank you for watching my channel. Subscribe if you like, and we'll talk to you again soon.